welcome you to our service. There is a visitor's card in the pew in front of you, and if you would say, take some time and fill that out so we could have a record of your visit. And also, there's also places where we can find out more about you, and you can find out more about us. And you can always visit our website at libertybconline.org if you want more information about our church, but we're certainly glad to have you visiting this morning. I would draw your attention to your proclaimer, for there's a number of announcements in there, but the main one I want to make this morning is that you need to come back tonight. Our children's choir is presenting their musical, their spring musical, Simon Says, and it's the rockin' trial of Simon Peter. And I was with them yesterday practicing and listening to them, and they certainly are rocking. So I invite you to come back and enjoy that fun time as we learn more about Simon Peter. Also, our Bible school is approaching, our Athens Bible School. Many of you have signed up to help with that, and they still need more workers, I think. So if you're interested, please see Sandra Landry or Joanne Goodrich, and they will plug you in somewhere. There's also a table out in the foyer there as you go to Sunday school today. If you want to pre-register your child for Bible school, you can do that. There's also a meeting, I think, Tuesday night at 7 for all the workers. So if you've signed up to work for that, they would like to see you Tuesday night at 7. Well, we've got a number of things also coming up, our Thunder in the Sky and our King's Car Show, and you can read more about those in your proclaimer. There's also some handouts in the vestibules. If you would take some of those and give them to your neighbors and friends and people at work, and anybody you can think of, carry some in your car, on your bicycle, or whatever, however you get around, on your moped, and whenever you can give somebody one of those to let them know about what's happening at the church. Well, we're so glad that you're here this morning. Especially, we're going to be honoring our graduates today. So let's stand, find somebody around you that you don't know, tell them you're glad they're here this morning. Welcome them to our church. Let's sing together.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sun. For I'm part of the family, the family.
Worship today. Let's lift up the name of our Savior.
Blessed Savior.
Father, we come before you this morning, praising your holy name, thanking you that you did come down from heaven to earth, and that you did make a way for us as sinners to be reconciled to you. And so today we come praising the name of Jesus, the name above all names. And we bow down before you now, Lord, just thanking you so much for the opportunity we have to gather in this place. We thank you for each one that's here, Lord, and we thank you for the word that you have to speak to us today. Father, we know we come into this place, Lord, many of us with struggles, heavy hearts, Lord. But we know that you are the one who can give us victory in all things. We know that you can heal every broken heart. We know that you can even heal the sickness in our bodies. And so, Father, we just come before you, Lord, knowing that we must rely on you for everything. And, Lord, we just thank you for your wonderful love towards us. We thank you that you do encounter us along the way. And Lord, would you help us today to just hear from your word, hear from your spirit, Lord, and act accordingly. We just thank you and love you in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Well, today is a very special day in the life of our church. We come to this time of year, and it's graduation time. The many people who have graduated already or are soon to graduate, and we love to just honor our graduates on this Sunday, and we have a few that are in the 8:30 service. Many will be in the 11 o'clock, but we have a few that we'd like to recognize in our 8:30 service, and so if you are a graduate, I call your name. I would like for you to just to come down front. We'd like for you to stand up here just for a few minutes so everybody can get a good look at you. And then, if your name is not called and you graduated from either high school or college or graduate school, then we'd like for you to also come down so we can recognize you. But this morning there are three names that I have. The first is Justin Lawson. I believe I saw Justin. There he is. Justin is a graduate of CVCC, and you're graduating from high school, right? And he's going to CVCC. See, I'm already confused. He's graduating from Appomattox High School, and his future plans are to go to CVCC, so we're just happy for Justin. Next is Scott. Oh, yeah. You can stand right there just for a second and look at you a little more, Justin. Next is Scott Henshaw. I didn't see Scott. He may come to the 11 o'clock service. He usually is at 8:30. Anyways. Scott is a graduate of Hampton-Sydney College. His major is in history, and he has a minor in national security and military leadership studies. Wow, that's a mouthful.
We just thank God for Scott, and we can give him a hand even though he's not here, you know? And then the last one is, now you're going to have to help me with the name. What's your daughter's name? Shakia. So Shakia Penix is graduating with her bachelor's degree in government and politics and also in criminology and criminal justice. Wow, so that's wonderful. We can thank the Lord for her. Is there anyone else at this time who's graduating from either high school or college that we have missed and we'd like to recognize you? Yes, sir. Your son is. What's your son's name? Joshua C. And what's he? Is he graduating from high school or college? Okay. Okay, so Joshua is going, he's graduating from high school, going to the Army to be a mechanic. So we'll just... We just thank the Lord for these graduates and for their achievements. Why don't we just have a prayer for them at this time? Lord, we just thank you so much for our graduates, Lord, that we can honor today. We thank you for their achievements, for their hard work. Father, I pray a special blessing on them as they continue on their path, Lord, that you would guide them, that you would make them ever knowing of your presence, and that, Father, that you would guide them in their ways, Lord. And I just thank you so much for the blessing of academics, Lord, that we get to learn and know more in this world, Lord, but we just want to learn and know more about you as we grow. And so, Father, I just pray for them that you would make their paths straight. Be with their families, as many of them will be going away to college. And Father, would you just help them to just continue in the way that they should go? We thank you for all this. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Jesus, draw me close. Let me walk with you. For you, Lord, are my all in all, everything that I need. Let's stand together as we sing about Jesus being our all in all.
Yesterday, I asked God for a testimony, and with your permission, I'd like to share it with you. I was out using a weed trimmer and some heavy brush yesterday, and a cicada flew right into my face. As I reached up and I slapped at my glasses. My fingers caught my glasses, and I don't know where they went. But after about an hour, I would say, a long time, being down on my knees, back and forth, looking everywhere for my glasses, I finally gave up. And I said, Lord, you know, I quit. I can't find them. Give me a testimony. I just said, give me a testimony. And I opened my eyes, and within seconds, there were the glasses right in front of me. What a marvelous God we have. What a coincidence. So let's pray. God, our Father, we bow before you now, thankful, Heavenly Father, that you, the God of all creation, the God of the universe, the God of life, see fit to, with great love, reach into our lives and reveal yourself in such marvelous ways that you care about us, even the little things. And so, Heavenly Father, we thank you for that. And Heavenly Father, as we respond to your love and give ourselves to you this morning, it's our prayer that you would take what we give and that you would use it in such a way that it would honor you and that it would bring forth your kingdom. This is our prayer, Heavenly Father, that you would just be glorified today in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Savior,
Well, I feel like we could just say amen, and that would be it. I could dismiss you. You know, after that song, I feel like that not too much more I could say that would be helpful to us this morning. But I just thank you so much for that song. Thank you for all the hard work, all the folks that did that. I'm not Rusty. My name is not Rusty. My name is Matt. And I'm quite a bit shorter than Rusty is. And I just ask that you would pray for me as I preach for him. He's away this week, but surely he'll be back next week. But this morning I want to start off our time together with just something funny that happened. Now, whether you realize it or not, every week this broadcast goes out onto the internet on a site called Ustream. And there are at least two people that don't live in Appomattox that watch our services every week, and they're my mom and my dad. What happens is, I call my parents once every, not enough, I know, I don't call my parents enough, but I call and they'll say to me at some point during the conversation, yeah, we saw you at the 8:30 service and you looked a little tired, or you made a really good, my parents know all the announcements because they watch me give the announcements every week, and so they know everything that's going on in the life of our church, okay? But my mom, I'm going to tell on her a little bit, and I'll know that if she's watching because I'll get a phone call later. But I'll tell on her a little bit. She said, you know, Matt, I'll tell you, sometimes I just watch you do the announcements, but I don't always listen to Rusty preach. And I'm like, I didn't ask her about the music. She probably listens to the music, too. That's encouraging. But, you know, it's funny that she would do that. But anyways, that's neither here nor there. But hopefully, I told them that I was preaching this morning, and so they may be watching right now and getting mad, but that's okay. Anyway, I want to begin our time together with something that I came across a few years ago. There's a website and a movement that's going on that I wanted to bring to our attention this morning, and the name of the movement, the website, is I Am Second. Okay, and I Am Second was started in 2008 by Norm Miller, who is the CEO of Interstate Batteries. And he's a Christian man, and he had a desire to begin this website and really just had one purpose when he started it. His purpose was, and this is from the website, to inspire others to begin or grow in their relationship with Jesus. And so you can go online, iamsecond.com, and I'm giving them a free plug, and you can go online and you can watch all of these different films. It's very simple. There's just a white chair. There's not a lot of production value, but it's people who stand there. They just sit there and they tell their story. He has secured the testimonies of both famous and non-famous people. Heavy metal rock band guy, Brian Welch, soul surfer Bethany Hamilton, rapper Lecrae, baseball star Josh Hamilton, actor Stephen Baldwin, country music star Josh Turner, Christian singer Michael W. Smith, Kathy Ireland, the supermodel, NFL coach Tony Dungy, even Mike Huckabee are all on this website telling simply the story of their life before Christ, how they were introduced to Christ, and the effect that it has had since they met Christ. And I think it's wonderful that there are famous people, sure, but there are also non-famous people, people just like you and I, who have accepted Jesus Christ as Savior. And in spite of their struggles, in spite of whatever may have happened to them in the past, they have felt the love of Jesus Christ, and it has made all the difference in the world. And today I want to talk about another person who met Jesus along the way. Many of these people, they talk about how they were going about their lives, and then all of a sudden they met Jesus, whether it's at church or at some other event, Christian event, or through a Christian friend, they met Jesus. But today I want to talk about another man who met Jesus along the way. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9. Our church is, while you're turning, you know, our church is involved in this idea of discipleship. Rusty is preaching through the Gospels and talking about what is Jesus' methodology for discipleship. How does Jesus deal with the process from when you accept Christ until the end of your life? What does that look like? How do you grow in grace and knowledge? And so today we're going to look at a famous person who accepted Christ, but we're going to look at what was going on immediately before he accepted Christ. And that is, we know him as the Apostle Paul, but at this point in his life, they would know him as Saul. Okay, so in Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 18 is where we're going to be today. So read with me the word of God. It says in chapter 9 of the book of Acts, verse 1 says, "Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. He went to the high priest and requested letters from him to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any men or women belonging to the way, that being Christianity, he might bring them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he traveled and was nearing Damascus, a light from heaven suddenly flashed around him. Falling from the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?' 'Who are you, Lord?' he said. 'I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting.' And he replied, 'But get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do.' The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the sound but seeing no one. Then Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. They took him by the hand and led him into Damascus. He was unable to see for 3 days and did not eat or drink." Bit of a story change now. It goes verse 10. There was a disciple in Damascus by the name of Ananias. And the Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias, here I am, Lord," he said. "Get up and go to the street called Straight," the Lord said to him, "to the house of Judas, and ask for a man from Tarshish named Saul, since he is praying there. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and placing his hands on him so that he may regain his sight." Verse 13, "Lord," Ananias answered, this is interesting, "I have heard from many people about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem, and he has authority here from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to him, 'Go, for this man is my chosen instrument to take my name to the Gentiles, kings, and Israelites. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name.' So Ananias left and entered the house. Then he placed his hands on him and said, 'Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road you were traveling, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit.' At once, something like scales fell off of his eyes and he regained his sight. And he got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength." Wow. So we see here in the beginning of chapter 9, we see that Paul, we would call him Paul, but at this point he's Saul. Saul is on the Damascus Road. He's on his way. And a few things to realize is that Saul was on a mission, right? He was on a mission. Verse 1 and 2 says, "Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord." Don't take for granted that the man who wrote most of the New Testament was once a persecutor of Christians. He was the very epitome of anti-Christian. He was against everything that disciples of Jesus stood for. He was as far from Jesus as you could be. And what we realize is that the first point today, God helps us to encounter Jesus even when we are far away from him. And that's a wonderful thing, that even though we are far from Jesus, he comes to us. He finds us where we are. Also, we know that Saul was a religious man. He was thinking that he was doing something great for God. He had been trained in the way that a good Jew would have been trained. He knew the law. He knew the prophets. He understood them. But he had missed one thing: that when Jesus came on the scene, it changed everything. That when Jesus Christ came down from heaven and was born and lived this perfect life and died on that cross but was raised again, that means something. That means something to Saul in his day. Saul was a religious person, but he had missed it. And so often it's easy for us to become religious, but for us to miss Jesus along the way. We get how to come in to this place and do the things that we're supposed to do. We understand that we're supposed to pray and to give and to talk to people. But we miss the beauty and the simplicity of knowing and loving Jesus and sharing that love with people around us. Saul was a follower of something, but it happened to be the wrong thing. He was going in the wrong direction. I remember when I was in high school, I played football, and there was a particular play that stuck out in my mind. There was a big guy, big, huge guy, and he played defensive line. And all he ever talked about was, man, if I ever get the chance, if there's a fumble and I ever get the chance to pick it up, I'm going to score a touchdown. Nobody's going to be able to tackle me. I said, okay, man, calm down a little bit, but that's okay. You get excited, right? And so he said, you know, if I get the chance, and then finally he gets his chance. So there's a play, and the offense fumbles the ball, and he picks it up, and he's so excited. He starts running. He doesn't really know what to do, but he just picks the ball up, and he just starts running. And he's running, and he's running, and everybody's screaming and shouting. And then all of a sudden, he gets tackled. He's like, oh, man, he looks over, and it's one of his own teammates. Gets up, what are you doing? Teammate goes, what are you doing? You are running the wrong way. You are running towards their goal when you're supposed to be running towards our goal. See, he had gotten excited, and he knew that he was supposed to do something, but he had gotten confused and had gone the wrong way. We must realize that we are all putting our faith somewhere, but much like my friend in high school playing football, we can pick up and get excited, but be going in the wrong direction. How easy is it for us to get off track in our Christian lives? How easy is it for us to become religious instead of becoming faithful followers of Jesus that love the simplicity of knowing and sharing Jesus? We must realize that we are putting our faith in something, whether it be our money, our jobs, even our families can become idols. And that's what the Bible talks about. It says that we are all idol worshipers. If we are left to our own devices, if we're not daily relying on Jesus, that we will create idols for ourselves. And so we must realize that we are idol factories, and that unless we take time to know ourselves and seek Jesus and seek to make him the center of everything, these bad things and maybe even some good things will take us further and further away from Jesus, and we will find ourselves far from Jesus. Indeed. He meets us. The beautiful thing, though, is that God meets us even though we are far from him. Don't discount the fact that no matter how far away from Jesus you are never beyond his reach. Amen? Amen? I mean, come on, people. If Jesus' love is not radical towards me, I'm in trouble. If Jesus' salvation is not far-reaching, then I have no hope. If Jesus only takes the people that are semi-religious and doesn't take the people who are far from him, then I'm in trouble, guys. I don't have a way to get back to God. But bless God that he reaches far and pulls us back in. He reaches as far as we can go, and he calls to us, and he meets us wherever we are. The second point today is that God helps us to encounter Jesus by revealing Jesus to us along the way. Look in verse 3. As he was traveling and was nearing Damascus, a light from heaven suddenly flashed around him. He falls to the ground and he hears a voice. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he has a question. Saul has a question. Who are you? Jesus responds, I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Notice a few things here. First of all, we experience the power of Jesus. Saul experiences it in verses 3 and 4. He is literally knocked off of his path. Secondly, he experiences the voice of Jesus, an audible voice from heaven that speaks to him directly. And thirdly, he experiences the incapacitation of Jesus. Never mind that he gets knocked off of his horse, but now he can't even see anymore. He gets up and he tries to go on about his way, but he realizes he can't see. And then it also says that he's unable to see for 3 days and did not eat or drink. This is dramatic. God literally knocks Saul off of his horse. There's a blinding light, and all at once, things are not as they were before. He's going about his business, and God reaches down and makes himself known. You know, and I wonder this morning, has anything like this ever happened to you? Has anything like this ever happened to you? You're going about your business, and suddenly you find yourself completely lost. You're somewhere that you thought you would never be, with people you thought you would never be with, in a situation that seems too great to overcome. You know, it's interesting that this is a big moment in Saul's life, but it's also a very terrifying moment. This is not a happy, happy, joy, joy kind of moment for Saul. This is a terrifying and scary and confusing moment in many ways. This gives me hope because there have been times in my life when I've been terrified. I've been confused. I've not known which way to turn. But you know, the beautiful thing is that when we face these things, that maybe it's not that life has thrown us a curveball. Maybe it's not that, oh, something bad has just happened. But maybe it's that God has allowed these things into our lives to knock us off track. And I'm not saying that whatever has happened to you is your fault. And I'm not saying that, but maybe it is. And maybe what's going on is a direct result of getting away from Jesus, but also maybe this is just a wake-up call for you to realize just how much you need Him. Maybe you've experienced it. It's the loss of a loved one or the loss of a job. Maybe it's just the sudden realization that you are now responsible for yourself and for a family. This is scary. So what are we to do? Well, Saul's lying there on the ground, face to face with the startling news that he's been fighting for the wrong team. What does he do? Well, what do we read in the text? Not much. He lays there. He's unable to do anything. He can't save himself. He can't make his eyes work again. He is completely at the mercy of God in this moment. But this is not a bad thing, friends. All he does, and all this is our application point, he listens to Jesus in that moment. There's no five-step plan for getting his sight back. There's no easy way for him to please God in this moment. He must just sit back and listen. We must learn that when God brings us low, our job is not always to try to fix it instantly, but maybe it's to take in what God is trying to teach us. What is God trying to teach me when He brings me low? What is God trying to teach me when I'm confused or hurt or sad or grieving? What is God trying to teach me in that moment whenever I am at my lowest point, when I've reached the end of my rope and all I can do is tie a knot and hold on? Maybe we realize that God is there. Maybe that's enough for you to realize that God has not left you and He has not forsaken you, and that He is speaking to you. And one way that He does speak to you is through the faithfulness of other Christians. The third point today is that God helps us to encounter Jesus through the faithfulness of other Christians. Acts 9, verse 10 says, "There was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias, and the Lord said to him in a vision, 'Ananias.' And Ananias says, 'Here I am, Lord.' And then God gives him instructions about what it is that he is supposed to go and to do." We meet this in the middle of Saul's story. We meet this other guy. And you might ask, if you're reading the text, you might say, well, where does this other guy come from? What has he got to do with Saul? I thought this was about God and Saul and Saul's journey to getting back to God. But don't discount that, because in verse 10, God puts this in here for a reason. He inserts a faithful Christian man to give the message of good news to Saul. He inserts a faithful Christian to give him the message of Jesus. He uses another believer. God gives clear instructions to his disciple. And then lastly, we'll see that Ananias' response is leery, but it's obedient. I love this about the Bible. I love this about the text, that in verse 13, Ananias has sort of a real moment with God, right? We tend to read the Bible like it's just, you know, an instruction manual, but this is a story. And so what happens is that Ananias says, "All right, Lord, I understand what you want me to do, but do you know what you're asking of me?" Verse 13, "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard from many people about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has authority here from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name." Ananias knows full well who Saul is. He knows full well that Saul has these murdering tendencies when it comes to disciples of Jesus. I mean, verse 1, he was still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. But here we go. Ananias gets a clear message from Jesus, a clear message from God to go to Saul. Verse 15, "Go, for this man is my chosen instrument to take my name to the Gentiles, kings, and the Israelites. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." You know, in many ways, this is the way that God operates. God uses others to speak the truth to us, and we are blessed by those who do speak truth to us. I hear all the time in my head, Rusty telling me that we must be truth tellers in a truth-fearing world. Now, he didn't make that up. He got that from somebody else. But we must be truth tellers in a truth-fearing world. And that's a great thought, that in this world that wants to deny truth, in this world that wants to embrace the lie of Satan, that we are to be truth tellers, not only to ourselves, first and foremost, we must tell the truth to ourselves, but we must also tell the truth to those who we encounter. I remember I was 10 years old when I accepted the Lord Jesus as my Savior. 10 years old. We were having revival services. This is when I was down in Georgia, and we're having revival services, and Friday night was youth night. This is when we get the young kids, and they come down, they sit down front, and we had to like sing and all this stuff, and it was a lot of fun. I mean, I could hold a tune, I guess, but you know, and it was a lot of fun for me. And they always brought a young buck. We'll get one of those young preachers to come in and preach to these youth. And I was like, okay, great. So here we go. And so I'm sitting. If the preacher's standing here, I'm sort of sitting like right over here, and I'm looking right at him. I'm just like, okay. And the guy's name is Josh Pritchett. And I don't keep in touch with Josh. I probably should call the guy and let him know that he's in my message today. But that's all right. I called, and so Josh, he begins to preach, and he's not that old. He's only about 16 or 17 years old at this point, but he begins to bring a word. And you know, Josh was speaking, but it was God who was speaking to my heart through him. And what I could gather from him, and I remember now, is that he said, "You have a choice to make. That there's no two ways about it. That there are only two types of people in this world. There are those who accept and follow Jesus, and there are those who don't. And that not making a decision, that saying that you don't choose a side, is choosing a side." And the power of the Holy Spirit convicted me in that moment. And it wasn't the most eloquent message. And he wasn't the best speaker in the world. But God spoke to me through him, and I fell down on my knees right where I was, and I knew instantly that I was lost and that I needed to be saved on that day. And so at that point, I began to cry, and I just began to be so heartbroken over my sin and heartbroken over who I was apart from Christ. But then the glorious hope, these two deacons in the church, they got right around me, and they began to pray over me. They began to pray and speak the truth of God's word in my ears, and that filled my mind. and I began to speak openly with God. And then it was like a weight had been lifted off of me. I had accepted the love of Jesus. And I felt that just peace and joy that came into my life. But God used a man. God used a person to speak the truth to me. God spoke through him to me. I can tell you of other times whenever God has used people to speak to me, maybe when I've been far away from him, and they've gently told me about the love of Jesus, and it's brought me back. But please, hear me, that God desires to speak to you, right? God wants to speak to you from other people, but he also wants to speak through you. I tell the youth all the time that if you know Jesus as Savior, that you have a story to tell. You have something to say. Oh, I don't know all the Bible verses, and I can't tell you where. All I know is John 3:16. Well, that's fine. Start there. But what we need to realize is that if we have Jesus, that we have something to tell. And there is a lost and dying world out there that needs to hear the message of hope. Amen? There's a community that needs to know that there are people who love one another and are willing to work together for a common goal, and the common goal is to glorify our God in heaven. God has used many people, even some in this room. I look around this auditorium and I see people. God has used you to speak truth into my life, and I thank you so much for that. So the application of that is that we look for people, good people to be around. We look for good Christian influences, people who will speak the truth to us. We all like to have a bunch of yes men around us, but what we need is sometimes somebody who will tell us a hard truth, somebody who will confront us with our path that has gone off track. We need to look for good friends. We also need to be a good friend. I know many people who would say that they have good friends, but if I ask them, okay, well, if this person is doing, I've heard that your friend has been doing X, Y, and Z, well, you know, it's not my place to tell them how to live their life. It's not my place to go and to judge them. My response to them is, you don't have to judge them, but do you love them? They say, of course I love them. They're my friend. Well, and my response to them is, isn't it a loving thing for you to go to that person and to tell them the truth? Is it not an act of hatred for you to keep the truth from them, to allow them to continue on in whatever way that they think they should be going? But God is looking for faithful Christians. God is looking for us to be faithful. Faithful first to hear his message, and then faithful after that to give his message. Last point today is that God helps us to encounter Jesus by opening our eyes and revealing our purpose. So we come to the resolution. So Ananias comes to Saul and he tells him this incredible truth. And he says, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road you were traveling has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Ananias lays hands on Saul and begins to speak God's message to him. He tells Saul first who's responsible for his current state. He says, "Listen, Saul, I'm going to tell you, it was Jesus that you met. It's Jesus that is calling your name right now. It is God himself who has reached down and has incapacitated you for a purpose. And that purpose is that you might be filled with the Holy Spirit." He also tells Saul something, and then you get this dramatic hearing of Saul. Saul hears it and then receives the truth, and then something amazing happens. But before we get to that, we see that God begins to open Saul's eyes. He begins to open his eyes to the poverty around him. I remember when God began to open my eyes to the poverty, not necessarily here, but I remember when I went to Honduras in February, My eyes were open to the poverty there and just to the things that you could not even think would be imaginable. People eating out of gutters. It is horrible. But there is poverty in this world, friends. There is abject poverty. And God is asking us, we don't have to be the savior of everyone, but we sure need to do our part. We sure need to give what we can give and go when we can go so that this doesn't stand in our lives, that we don't just stand back and go, wow, that's really sad that those people live like that. We must realize that our eyes can be opened to sadness in this world. I went on a mission trip to Ukraine, and I worked with orphans there, and the sadness that they had was overwhelming. My eyes were opened. I began to see things differently. When I went on a mission trip to Turkey, and I saw the lostness. Our community is lost, absolutely. There are many in our community who don't know Jesus. But when you go to a Muslim country and you realize that if you were to call the name of Jesus, that probably nobody that hears your voice has ever accepted Jesus, that there are no other Christians around you, that is lostness. And that opens your eyes. When our eyes are open, it changes things. We can't go the same way as we were before. We can't think about things in the same way. When our eyes are opened, it makes all the difference in the world. And we see Paul. What happens here? Verse 18. At once, something like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight, and he got up and was baptized. And after taking some food and water, he regained his strength. But don't miss this. I'll end with this. But don't miss the message that Ananias gives to Saul. Go back a few verses. In verse 16, it says, I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. God makes good on his promise to give Saul a new direction, but that doesn't make it easy. Maybe you're here today and you need a new direction. Maybe you feel like you have no purpose, or that your purpose has been so lost in the mud and the muck of life, or so beaten down that you don't know which way you should go. And you don't know what God would have for you to do next. Well, we are blessed, friends, that even though we may feel far from God, He is here with us today. And He is revealing Himself to us even now through the Holy Scriptures and through the Holy Spirit. And He is calling for us now to follow Him. And the question is, will you follow, will you come and follow Him? But maybe you're not like Saul. Maybe you're more like Ananias. You're the one who has accepted Jesus. You're the Christian. The Lord is speaking to you as well, placing someone on your heart that needs to hear the life-giving message that the Lord Jesus has sent me, that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. My prayer for all of us is that we realize that when God speaks to us, that it has application for our lives. That when God speaks through His Word, that we must take that Word and give it to those around us. Well, maybe you're here today and you don't know the love of Jesus because you've never accepted Him. Maybe you're sitting in that pew and you realize for the first time that you need a Savior and that you need to be saved. Well, in just a few moments, we're going to have a song, and I invite you to come and to speak with me, and I can show you what it means to be a Christian. Or maybe this is also a time for you to come down front and bow before the altar and cry out to God. Maybe you're that Christian person who's lost their way, and you just need for God to speak to you again, or you need to cry out to Him about whatever's going on in your life. Or maybe there in your seat, you just need to take a few moments and reflect on, first of all, how much God has blessed you to hear the message, but also how you can be an Ananias. You can be a truth teller to people around you. Why don't we pray together? Heavenly Father, I thank You for Your message, Lord. I thank You for the goodness that You have shown us, Lord, in the person of Jesus. I thank you that, Lord, even though we're far away from you at times in our life, that, Lord, you're always there. Father, help us never to quench your spirit. Help us to never turn our backs on your word. Father, would you help us to respond in truth to what you speak to us? And Father, if we are compelled, would you move our hands and our feet to action so that we might be faithful followers of Jesus? And so, Lord, we just we give this time to you, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together.
Stand together.
Thank you that you are near. We thank you that you are not far away from us. You've not left us or forsaken us. Lord, we thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit that guides us into all truth. Help us to be sensitive to His calling in our lives. And Father, we just thank You so much for the wonderful sacrifice and the wonderful continued work of Jesus. We thank You that He stands now to intercede for us. He stands now to intercede on our behalf so that we might have a way back to You. Father, I just pray for us as we leave this place that we would be faithful followers of You, and that, Lord, as we meet You along the way each day, that we would respond in truth, that we would do Your will in our own lives, in our families, and in our community. And we thank You for that wonderful privilege, and go now in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much.